So next up, I'm absolutely delighted to welcome a councillor who was one of our first ever supporters, who, in my view, is doing more to drive the business agenda to being a force for good in the world than any other business leader. I mean, I think one of the things we believe at One Young World and one of the things that our fantastic sponsors believe is that business can be part of the solution and that business can be a force for good. He was recently awarded his third honorary doctorate by the Business School at Lausanne, and his co-honorary was also Kate. So Kate is now a doctor, Dr. Kate Robertson, and Paul Polman, who I'm going to be welcoming to the stage in a moment, is also Dr. Paul Polman. He's been in business for 35 years, made an unbelievable contribution. Ban Ki-moon appointed him as one of the 27 members of the UN high-level panel on the eminent persons on the post-2015 development agenda. He's also the chairman of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And when he announced at Davos that he was going to set out to halve Unilever's emissions and double its profit, it sent shockwaves through the business world and was an unbelievable example of leadership. And despite doing all of that, he still finds the time to come here and be with us. And so welcome back for the fourth time to One Young World, our great friend, Paul Polman.
Haven't seen you in a long time. How are you doing?
Dr. Paul.
I was just looking at the, who was here at 8 o'clock this morning? I think you all need to stand up and sit down again. I wouldn't be able to sit for 3 or 4 hours in the chair without moving. Why don't everybody stand up? That's what you need to do. And just shake it a little bit. How does that feel, better? Okay, now I need to get going. I was just backstage listening to this enormous panel that was just on here, and I was talking to a volunteer. She's Daisy is her name. She studies law here in Dublin, and she said to me, "That's a tough act to follow." So I have to really thank David and Kate to put me right after this panel. It's about the worst thing that can happen to you. I guess Bob Geldof is worse if you follow him. But I'll promise you, in my talk, I won't use the F word. There are other words in the vocabulary to make things clear. So, anyway, I want to first congratulate Dr. Kate because she got honored for all the work she does with you guys and making this a better world for all. So, Dr. Kate. And the same is true for David, what he does now with young entrepreneurs and getting people going. It's you know, one of the things in life is to put yourself to the service of others, and I can't think of two better people that do this, having created One Young World. This is my fourth time I'm here, and it's worth it. The energy that it gives to you, undoubtedly, but rest assured, the energy that it gives to us. But not only the energy, it's the hope. It's the hope for a better future. You know, this is Dublin, and it's actually appropriate that it's in Dublin. I was looking a little bit little things about Dublin to get to know the city a little better. It's actually the youngest capital city in Europe. Average age is actually below 35 years old. So it's actually a very good thing that One Young World is in Dublin. And guess again, if you read the history of Dublin or the history of Ireland, there have been incredibly tough times. There have been famines. There have been enormous levels of unemployment, insecurity. We just went through that again with the last crisis. And each time it bounces back to be vibrant and looking positively to the future. There's no better metaphor for One Young World, I think, than the city of Dublin, where you're in right now. I came in yesterday night late, and we had a dinner with, we have about 50 or so delegates from Unilever here. So welcome, everybody. And we had a little Q&A in the hotel. In fact, I saw Kofi Annan just before that, and I said, come along, but unfortunately, David had more pulling power for his dinner. So thank you, so we missed him on ours. But I was listening to what you were talking about. I was listening to your talking about Mary Robbins talking about climate justice, how climate change affects the poor more than anybody else, that it's time for us to act. I heard Michael talk about that this morning. You've heard other speakers, undoubtedly Kofi Annan, talking about someone's inner value, what makes you a leader, putting yourself to the service of others. Undoubtedly, when you hear Mohammed Yunus tomorrow talk about social entrepreneurs, people like yourselves, many of you here in the audience, change the world for a better place. I thought that's a little difficult act to follow when you have those speakers. And having been here for the fourth year, I had the normal thing about what do companies do and the corporate talk, and I thought that's really a waste of time because there are more important things in the world than that. The more important things in the world that these people express, because what these people have in common, be it Kofi, be it Mary Robbins, be it Mohammed Yunus and many others that you will hear, is that these people simply put themselves to the service of others. They know that by investing in others, others will invest in them. They know by focusing on the people that can't help themselves, they'll unlock the full potential of everybody. Just like you heard on this panel here, how to unlock the full potential of everybody. In this case, a gender panel, but it's the same for everybody else as well. It was Dickens who said 150 years ago, he wrote this book, The Tale of Two Cities. He was talking about London and Paris, but one of the first sentences he writes in that book was, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. I don't want to make you depressed at all. I'm actually an optimist, otherwise I wouldn't be standing here. I've said many times in my life, it's too late to be a pessimist. So we have to be optimistic, but these are very challenging times that we live in, and I think many of you have heard previous speakers refer to that. But there are also enormous progress we've made over the last 30, 40 years. In fact, we have lifted more people out of poverty in the last 30 years, 400 million people, than at any time before. More people have access to education now than any time before. More people have access to technology. The world is more connected despite what you hear or what you read. Despite the terrible, tragic Ebola crisis, actually, medicine has pushed life expectancy for basically all countries in the world. We are fundamentally a significantly better place. In fact, the Millennium Development Goals that were made 15 years ago in 2000 that run through 2015 basically talk about halving the number of people living in poverty, at that time defined as $1.25 a day. We actually have achieved that target. A lot of people say it's due to China or it's always due to something, but we have achieved the target of reducing the people living in poverty by half. So we should be enormously proud. But at the same time, as you heard Michael talk about with the UN, the job is not finished. Still, if we've halved the number of people living in poverty, it still means that there are quite a lot of people living in poverty. And I think you have a wonderful opportunity as your generation to do something that nobody has done before. You'll be the first ones to do it. And if you do it, nobody has to do it anymore after you. So you'll be the only ones to do it. And that is to irreversibly eradicate poverty in a more sustainable and equitable way. If we decide in the next 15 years, with the new Sustainable Development Goals coming up, that we are going to rise above our own self-interest, that we are going to give our energy to the ones that can't help themselves, we can actually eradicate poverty for everybody. And we can do that in a sustainable way so that future generations can have that same pleasure and in a more equitable and inclusive way. Who doesn't want to be part of that? Now, the interesting thing is when we were working on the post-2015 Millennium Development Goals, the comments we got back from people in terms of what they wanted to change, rule of law, child slavery, early child marriage, access to education for all, food security, and the list goes on. Most of these comments actually came from people in the emerging markets. What we often don't realize when we live in Europe, I'm from the Netherlands, or when we live in the US, that actually in about 30 years' time, which is not that far, you'll be 50, some of you might be 60, some of you might probably be even 35 or 40. I see some very young people in the audience. Or you feel young, that's the most important thing. But 80% of the world population will actually live outside of Europe and the US. And 50% of that population is below 25 years old. And what is interesting is if you go around the world, I just came back from a tour of Africa for 10 days, is that although they are half of the population today, they also understand that they're 100% of the population tomorrow. And they certainly do want to live in a better world. Now, here are the three big challenges that are coming together, why it's a little difficult. You heard Michael talk about the UN, and undoubtedly some other speakers about some of these challenges that we have. But at the same time, there are enormous opportunities. But there are, in fact, three things that are coming together at the same time that have never come together at the same time. And it's just happening now in these 10 to 15 years. That's why it's a little difficult. That's why you see the length of a CEO tenure go down to 4.5 years. That's why you see the length of a publicly traded company go down to 18 years. That's why you see politicians not getting re-elected again. In Europe, 75% are new in the European Parliament. What is happening that makes it so difficult to govern the world? Three major trends. The first one is a very simple one, what Kishore Mububani, who teaches at the Lee Kuan Yew School in Singapore, calls the new Asian hemisphere. The world is moving rapidly, and that's a good thing, to the emerging markets, rebalancing the power fields. If you go back 200 years, before the Industrial Revolution, the economic centers were actually in the Middle East or in the Far East. They closed off at that time, Industrial Revolution came, Europe and the US advanced. Now, at an enormous pace, quicker than we thought before, these balances are corrected. Now, that's a good thing to some extent, drives these people out of poverty, which we should give everybody opportunity to do. But at the same time, it also creates enormous stress in global governance. Institutions like the World Bank, the IMF, to some extent the UN, I heard the question from some of you, they have been designed in 1948, the time of Bretton Woods, the world was a different place, and these institutions had been designed with a different thing in mind. And as the world has evolved, these institutions, our way of governance has not evolved as quickly. Politicians have a hard time to internalize all these global challenges. As a result, very difficult to get climate change agreements, Doha rounds, the Rio Plus 20 document, without insulting anybody, was probably the lowest common denominator document. Syria on television is becoming a sad soap opera without people taking action. Global governance is at a stalemate. More geopolitical conflicts around the world than we've seen, at least in my history, and I think a little bit longer than that. The new Asian hemisphere, the world moving south and east. The second trend that happens at the same time as we do this is, as these economies develop and change these power fields, then obviously people improving their standard of living has also seen an enormous increase in consumption. That has happened at the same time as population has increased. In fact, we're having 4 times more consumption now than we had 30 years ago, with the combination of lifting people out of poverty and population increase. And as Keyes was explaining this morning when he did his collectively, we're living beyond the planetary boundaries. We're simply using more resources than we have. In fact, John Rockström from the Resilience Institute in Stockholm talks about 9 planetary boundaries, sort of biomarkers of what is the health of the planet. And he's very clear on biodiversity, on climate change, on nitrogen levels. We have passed the minimum acceptable levels. You heard Mary Robbins undoubtedly talk about the 2-degree challenge, how we have to make sure that by 2050 the world is climate neutral, or carbon neutral. In fact, the UN just published a study. In the last 10 years alone, the world has paid $2.7 trillion more in managing natural disasters, Hurricane Haiyan, Hurricane Sandy's, the droughts that you see in many parts of the world, and the floodings at the same time in others. Every day you switch on your television is a natural disaster. And that's only with 0.8 degrees increase. I personally even think that the 2 degrees is playing with fire. Let's at least try to get there. But the second trend is these planetary boundaries. I call that the end of the era of abundance. It's an enormous stress on people. And the third trend is, not surprisingly, the trend that you are probably most familiar with, because you're all sitting there with your telephones in your hands, is the digitization of society. We actually are more connected than we've ever been, 3.5-4 billion people. I always say that after China and India, Facebook is the 3rd biggest country in the world. We have 1.5 billion people connected, if not more. And increasingly, the people understand the power of that connection. It's a very interesting thing. Because actually, we live in a world where wealth seems to be each time more and more concentrated. But power, because of the connection, is increasingly dispersed. And these three factors I talk about, they obviously reinforce each other. Because power is more dispersed, politicians have a harder time to deal with it. Because we're at the end of the age of abundance, we get issues like climate change, are global issues, politicians have a harder time to deal with it. And these challenges require, obviously, solutions. Now, it was Winston Churchill who said, democracy is the worst form of governance except for all the other ones invented. And he was right. In fact, democracy is probably the best way to rule or govern a country. Democracy was simply invented to be sure that the voices of the majority were heard so that the minority would not abuse the majority. That is really the essence of democracy. And lo and behold, in many places it works. The first thing we always have to do is to be sure that there is rule of law, access to legal systems, no corruption, transparency in operations, especially at government levels as well. So that's the first thing. But democracy functions. Now the same can be said of capitalism. Capitalism is the worst form of governance invented, except for all the other ones. I've been around many places in the world. Frankly, I haven't found many better forms there either. But it is for sure that we have to evolve. There are many people that think the economic system will take care of itself. There will be price mechanisms, there will be invisible hands. You'll get the people like Milton Friedman's, the business of business is business. And that is where we went wrong, because we narrowly defined it. Unfortunately, if the free market, if the mechanisms we have created with democracy and capitalism were really functioning for us, just ask yourself just a few questions. Why is it that today, even 2,000 years after we more or less, more than 2,000 years, but we're living in 2014, why is it that today still nearly 800 million people go to bed hungry, not knowing even if they wake up the next day? Why is it still today that 2.5 billion people don't have access to safe water or sanitation? Why is it still today that 1 out of 20 children doesn't make it past the age of 5? I was in Sub-Sahara Africa or in India, 1 out of 5 children doesn't make it past the age of 5. Why is it still today that 48% of the world population has a marginal job, not being able to live less than $2 a day? Why is it still today that over 200 million people are unemployed? And by the way, all these statistics I give you affect the young, especially the women and the girls, if you want to peel the onion, more than anything else. Now, what is very clear to me is that if we have these challenges that we need to solve, if the system isn't quite in equilibrium, it will not function. It's a little bit like a cancer in your body. Any system in the world where too many people feel that they're not fully participating or that they feel that they're excluded from the system will ultimately reject itself. And we see that all over the world. I think you had one of the people talk here from Turkey on the square yesterday. Tashkent Square, whatever you called it. Tashkent Square. You saw the Arab Spring. What happened in the Arab Spring? There always was corruption. There always was volatile food prices. There always was high youth unemployment in Egypt. And yet the regime was there for 35, 40 years, the regime of Mubarak. Yet in 17 days, it changed what we now conveniently call the Arab Spring. We organize on Facebook. We communicate with each other on Twitter. And we show the world what we do on YouTube. It were the young people. It was the power of digitization. It took 17 days. The people in the street in Turkey were not in the street because some trees were cut on the square. They were there to ensure that governance would stay in place, in this case, a secular state. The people in Brazil were not in the streets because the bus fare went up. They were in the streets protesting against incompetence of governments or corruption. So anywhere you go in the world right now, the movements of change that are happening are the movements of change that start with the youth. There is absolutely no doubt about that. And businesses need to understand that as well. I've always posed a very simple question to fellow business people. If it took 17 days in Egypt to get an ingrained regime out of office, it frankly will only take nanoseconds to get businesses that are irresponsible out of office. And that we have to all understand. In fact, if you look at the statistics, it would be actually even more frightening. There are only 60,000 companies that are publicly traded, believe it or not. We should have many more, but many people prefer not to be publicly traded anymore with enormous pressures of the financial markets and short-termism and all the other things. Of these 60,000 companies that are traded, Pareto's law applies as well. Only about 1,000 of them make up half the market cap. These 1,000 companies have seen their market caps go up and down more like a yo-yo than at any time in the history. Why? Because all of a sudden, it wasn't beef, it was horse meat. All of a sudden, we find out that yes, the t-shirt was made in the Rana Plaza factory that collapsed. And by the way, the 1,050 women that lost their lives, what do you think they got paid? Anybody has a guess? 11 cents an hour. 11 cents an hour. The second lowest country in the world is Vietnam at 26 cents an hour. 11 cents an hour is close to modern-day slavery. And they knew the factory was collapsing, but they were forced in. Why? Because we think it's cool to buy a $1 t-shirt. It's not cool anymore. It's not cool anymore. The same thing can be said of manipulating of LIBOR rates or foreign exchange rates or any of the other things that we see occurring at an increasing pace. It's not that the world is worse now than it has been before. It's not that the business people are worse than it has been before. It is that the world has become more transparent. It is the digitization of society that has added an element of aggregation of discontent, that has added an element of transparency, that has added an element of speed. That's a good thing. It's a good thing if we can use this as a force for good. There is no better force for good than transparency. You cannot build trust, which you need to succeed, if you don't have transparency. You cannot build trust if you also don't have accountability. It's true in your life, it's true in my life. It's true for companies, it's true for governments, it's true for NGOs, it's true for everybody. At Unilever, and that's my only spiel about Unilever because they do pay my salary. At Unilever, we decided the company has done always well. That interested me in joining them 6 years ago, and I certainly haven't regretted that. The company has always had a philosophy of trying to do the right thing. But in the situation what we have to solve, it requires more than trying. In fact, I would say CSR, what we call conveniently CSR, corporate social responsibility, is simply not good enough anymore. I think, personally, that's a thing of the past. If you really want to participate as individuals, as companies, as governments, you have to be actively part now of improving things. Things like climate change, things like poverty, things like exclusion, things like equal rights. You have to improve things now, especially as you know that populations are going to increase and still many people need to be lifted out of poverty. You have to figure out ways to improve it now and for future generations to come. There are three challenges in that. I gave you three trends, there are three challenges as well. The first challenge we need to solve is a very simple one, but it's a difficult one to understand for us, which makes you sometimes doubt why we are the most intelligent species. And that's the battle of man versus nature. Frankly, there is no battle of man versus nature. It's man's stupidity to battle itself. Because even to the extreme that we would play even more with nature and challenge it, we would extinct ourselves. And it will only take about 150 years for nature to come back in its original state. There is actually no battle of man against nature. There's a battle of man against man. And if we don't figure out how to live in sync with our planet, we are actually the ones that are going to suffer. The second battle, which is not surprising, I've mentioned that before, is few versus many. A world where few decide and many suffer will not work too long. It has to be a world of all. When you read in a recent Oxfam study that 85 people in the world have the same wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people, it cannot be. It cannot be. If too many people, once more, are excluded from any process, they certainly will rebel. I think many of the geopolitical conflicts that you see across the world might have a banner in religion, and some of that is certainly true. I know Ajarat is here fighting enormously hard for no war in name of religion, which I think is the minimum we should accept. But actually, many of the wars that you see in the world have their origins in poverty. And poverty partly driven, in some of the cases, by climate change. So the second battle that we have is few versus many. And the third battle we need to solve is equally very clear, is the battle of short-term versus long-term. The challenges that we need to solve, food security, hunger, job creation, poverty alleviation, are problems you cannot solve on a quarterly basis. There are no 90-day solutions. If there would be 90-day solutions, someone would have done it for us already. So what we said in Unilever very simply is, call it the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. You can grow your business, many people still having to be lifted out of poverty, but do it in such a way that it decouples your growth from environmental impact, improve your social impact. Different than CSR, take responsibility of the total value chain, from the farm to the fork. If you're in the food business, take responsibility of trying to find solutions for people that go to bed hungry, play a role in solving the enormous epidemic that we get in obesity, try to help waste less food in the supply chain, and if 50% of the deforestation that is happening in this world comes because of demand of food, yes, also play a role in fighting illegal deforestation. By the way, illegal deforestation alone is 16% of global warming. It was Viktor Frankl who said in his book Search for Meaning that when they built the Statue of Liberty on the east coast of the United States, they forgot to build the Statue of Responsibility on the west coast of the United States. You cannot have liberty without responsibility. So if you're in the food business, move out of your CSR circle, take co-responsibility of the total value chain, and get involved in things that affect your total footprint. Then you can solve. You can solve many things in partnership with a long-term philosophy. For that reason, indeed, as David kindly announced, we stopped doing quarterly reporting, we stopped giving guidance, we did compensation systems for the long term. We cannot run these businesses for 90 days. Now, not surprisingly, it lowers your risk as a company if you're a little bit more socially responsible. It probably lowers cost, as you heard Ellen undoubtedly talk about yesterday, when you think about resource use. All of our factories are zero waste to landfill or green energy. It actually lowers the cost. It's a circular economy concept, as he talked about. Your reputation, your risk, your cost. Undoubtedly, your employee engagement goes up because people inherently feel better about doing the right thing than doing the wrong thing. I think that's true for all of us. We've seen engagement scores go up enormously. But what I get the most excitement about is the brands. How do you use your brands as a force for good? Every company should figure out why they're here. And it's very hard to justify that we're here for shareholders. We're here to solve some problems in society. These brands should be a force for good. And if these brands are a force for good, then you are able to do that in a responsible way, sure, other stakeholders will benefit as well, including shareholders. But you cannot just run your company for a shareholder. You have to run your company for a little bit of a deeper purpose. So a brand like Lifebuoy, which is one of our bar soaps, which is hand washing, is there to help a child reach the age of 5. Simple acts of hand washing prevents millions and millions of children under 5 from dying. A brand like Dove would actually have fit very well with the panel before. It's for women's self-esteem. I don't know how many saw sketches, Dove sketches on YouTube. You see, this is about 1/3 of you or half of you that have spent 3.5 minutes watching Dove sketches. You join the other 250 million that have done this. 250 million spending 3.5 minutes looking at a YouTube video, which you might call commercial. I mean, it's not even paid for. It went around like viral, like you wouldn't believe it. Tells you the power of connectivity and movement you can create if you do a force for good. By the way, Dove is doing fine. Brand is up 10%. Lifebuoy is doing fine. Now, Domestos, another of our brands, is not just there to clean toilets. Sure, it does that. But it's there to fight the issue of open defecation. You know, one of the goals I hold them accountable for is to be sure we built another 500,000 toilets for people that don't have them. One of the goals I hold Dove responsible for is to reach another 50 million women to give them self-esteem. Lifebuoy, the same thing. So, if these issues that society faces are infinitely big, the opportunities for brands to grow are even bigger. The last brand is Knorr. Knorr is a food brand. Put nutrition in there if you're in Africa, because the governments aren't able to distribute nutrition to the people when and where they need it. Work with smallholder farmers to create jobs. We have some people here from the foundations, like the World Food Program. Anna and Alex were telling me yesterday night the enormous strengths that they get from working with corporations like this to solve some of these issues like food security. In fact, yesterday, I'll put one slide up. Yesterday was World Food Day. There's the Zero Hunger Pledge. I don't know if there is a slide on that one. There's the Zero Hunger Pledge that the UN does now. We talked about the UN, all the good and bad things. I tend to believe there are more good things if we want them to be good, and there are more bad things if we want them to be bad. Depends on us how we behave. I can tell you the UN does a lot of good things. And one of the things is helping people be fed who can't feed themselves. If there are 1 million refugees in Syria that cross the border and are now in Turkey or in Jordan, who's going to feed them? Or are we just going to watch on television and look at the next statistic? That's why we have the World Food Program and many of the other humanitarian charities. These people are heroes. So have the courage, go to the website, look at the Zero Hunger Pledge and pledge. Just pledge yourself that these situations are unacceptable. Because there's one thing that is enormously powerful. It's the voice of the young. How many in the companies that you represent have filed petitions to change? You've all major petitions here that you think we need to do this and this to change the world. How many are petitioning your own management to change your companies? Enormous force. How many are truly putting their wallet where their mouse is by spending behind things that really count? Have you ever looked at what all companies are doing? What is important to you? Are you really acting on that? If we would all do it, I have no doubt we would change the world very, very quickly. But we don't. Use your combined power. Enormous networks are being created. One of the reasons I like One Young World and what Kate and David have been doing. Think about all the people that are here, all the people that came before you, all the people that you are connected with. Now connect that with other networks. Connect that with WeDay of Mark and Mark Kielberger and his brother. Connected with the Yashoko Fellows, the Global Shapers, with Jeremy Gillies, Peace One Day, has 1 billion people participating. If we can connect these networks of supposedly like-minded people who supposedly are going to act in a like-minded way, you can change the world in the direction we all need to do. And you can do it very, very quickly. Now, some people say, I don't want to work for corporates. And I think that's unfortunate. I certainly don't want to work for all the corporates either. But I certainly would want to work for companies that want to do the right thing. I personally believe that someone who works on Lifebuoy or Knorr or Dove is as much a social entrepreneur as anybody else. Talk to them, find out. They're driven as much by saving lives as an NGO of anybody else. Now, one of the things is what you can do by using your brands. The other thing is what you need to do if you have a certain size and scale. With liberty comes responsibility. If a company like Unilever or other great companies that are out there would do things and the rest of the world wouldn't, we still wouldn't have the impact that we needed. I have three children. They're your age. I can be feeling very good about all the things that we're doing. But my least concern, frankly, is Unilever. My least concern is Unilever. In fact, I'm concerned about it for a different way. If I look at Globe Scan and I see how far we're out there, or I look at the Dow Jones Sustainability Index and I see how far we're out there, or some of the other markers that we get from the outside world, I actually get worried. I get worried. Because we need critical mass of many more to make change for impact. So the key opportunity is transformational change through partnership. How can we really solve food security? By working together with many other companies and others. Initiatives like Grow Africa or the New Vision for Agriculture are trying to achieve that. How can we rally the industry, NGOs, civil society, governments to get out of the illegal deforestation? The Tropical Forest Alliance, the UN Declaration on Forests are actually meant to do that. Why is the UN so important? Because the UN is the body that is putting in the new post-2050 Millennium Development Goals, which probably is the only opportunity we have in this world, given the state of the current governance, to get a moral framework out there, a moral framework that nobody should be left behind. Irrespective of the country you come from, irrespective of your religion, irrespective of how much money you have or where you grew up, the concept of nobody being left behind is a universal one. And the UN, with its Millennium Development Goals, is probably the only one now placed to put that moral framework out there. And you, again once more, have to help push your governments and others to take the courageous stand to be sure that when we get these Millennium Goals that need to be finalized in the next year, that they are courageous. That they are not yet another common denominator document of 190 countries and a compromise that brings us to the lowest common denominator. You'll not be waiting for that. No, you are not, because you're fine. You could afford to be here, you've all gone to university. You have a reasonable life, you can decide where you want to work or not. But the ones that aren't here will be the ones that suffer much more. You don't have someone here speaking who goes to bed hungry every night because they're simply too weak to come here and speak. You don't have any of these children that have died under the age of five because they're not here anymore. Nor do you have many women or children who didn't have a chance to have access to education or avoided early child marriages. They're not sitting here either. You're doing this for them. They're the ones who are not here. You belong to the 2% of the world population, less than 2%, that can decide what you want to do, that are free to do and live where they want to live. The 98% isn't in that situation. If you belong to the 2%, I just have a very simple request to you. Put yourself to the service of the other 98%. It was in fact Gandhi who said, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. Thank you very much.